Hello, everyone. My name is Jordan Newman, and welcome to the Fandom Optimists. This is the show where every week we talk about the latest and greatest of our favorite fandoms, and we try our best to stay optimistic. This week, I am joined by improv badass, Thor enthusiast, and party connoisseur, Sim Singh. Sim, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you, Jordan?
I'm doing great because I watched the latest episode of Marvel's What If.
Oh my god, it was incredible.
Since I first heard the term party Thor, I've just been desperately waiting for this episode.
I'm just going to start off with this. Marvel never fails to amaze me. They fit so much into this half hour episode that it feels like its own movie.
It really I know that it's much more convenient to make these animated, but man, if they could have done these as live action movies, they would have been so cool.
Oh my goodness. Like, you know how much I love Thor. Like, he's my favorite Marvel superhero and probably superhero in general. I've always loved his like honesty, his courage, his bravery. And honestly, this episode took me by surprise. You just see him and it doesn't feel like he's worthy in this episode. He's just some, like, jerk. It's really weird to see.
He's such a dick. I don't get how he is worthy. Because for a second I thought, oh, this hammer doesn't have the enchantment. This guy's not worthy. But they got to that part. Full spoilers for everyone, by the way. I assume if you've clicked on this, you've watched the latest episode of What If. But they get to that part where he's fighting Captain Marvel and he like uses the hammer to keep her pinned to the ground. It's like, oh, so there is an enchantment.
Oh my gosh.
That she's not worthy. She's not worthy, but he is. I don't know how he's worthy in this.
So here's something that I did notice though. You kind of see the Thor that we were introduced to all the way back in the original Thor movie. Yeah. And you kind of see the same arrogance in him. That's the word I'm looking for. Ever since I saw the episode, I'm like, what is this term that I'm looking for that describes his personality? And it's arrogant because he's full of himself. He's stuck in his head, like that he's the greatest of all time. And he doesn't have Loki there to kind of kick him down a notch because, you know,
yes,
he's an only child now.
Oh, what I also love that that he and Loki are, like, friendlier in this than they are when they're actually brothers.
It's very funny. It's a very interesting dynamic because I can see that, you know, they didn't grow up. They weren't, like, internally competing with each other. There wasn't any resentment from Loki about not having a throne of his own. And so that's why they're so relatable because they each have their own thrones. They're each in their own worlds and they're both just chaotic.
It was so much fun to listen to Tom Hiddleston being like that.
Oh my goodness, as soon as I heard his voice, I was watching it with my boyfriend, and as soon as I heard his voice, he just looked at me and he's like, you're enjoying this way too much. I really am.
Oh, that voice is so silky smooth.
Oh my goodness, Loki, oh my gosh, I need to rewatch that series now.
Yes! Oh, it's due for a rewatch, I gotta go watch it again. I loved when he's on the phone with, firstly, that the phone is tiny for his giant hands.
Oh my goodness.
But when he's, oh, you're Thor's lady friend, hello.
You have another friend, double date. Because yes. That's not Loki behavior. It's very, like, in the original, like, Loki is, at least in the first Thor, very quiet, very reserved, because he does live in his brother's shadow. But now he has the spotlight all on himself, so he has that courage. He has that audacity to say things he normally wouldn't say.
Yeah, I hadn't been thinking about that, that it's just as much a what if Loki was an only child as well.
And this also kind of gets you thinking, like, the only reason why Loki would still be a frost giant is because Odin returned him to his parents. So that says something about Odin, too, about the decision he made to be a better ruler than what he was in the Thor universe. Because I'm going to be honest, in the original Thor, when you find out that, you know, he stole away this child, you kind of have to wonder what's going on in his head. Like, why would he take so, like this baby from a planet that he is at war with, and then continues this war and has this cold relation, pun intended, with the frost giants. But then in this universe, in this What If episode, he gives the child back and it mends that relation. So the Jotunheim frost giants are okay with Asgardians, and they're here they are. Thor and Loki are friends. So you have to wonder what kind of rule this would instill on Asgard in sort of a different sense. Maybe they're not as militarized. Maybe they're not, as kind of like rough in the edges. Maybe Odin isn't as tough of a ruler.
Yeah, that's a great point that a prime timeline, or I guess sacred timeline, according to the TVA, sacred timeline Odin was kind of a problem. He made all kinds of awful decisions.
He was very problematic. And something else I noticed, Frigga. Frigga was kind of like, she didn't really care as much about her son in the sense that, like, as soon as Odin went to sleep, she's like, okay, I'm gonna go party with my girlfriends. Like, she
Yeah.
didn't even think in once in her head that, she has to be there for Thor during this time.
Yeah, that's also a good point. Wow, so many things that I hadn't thought
I'm telling you, like I love the Thor lore, like Norse mythology, how they take it all, and just overall his world, his kind of the way he views things. It's very interesting. And I love the reference to the Thor movie when Jane gets the magic tattoo and Thor gets the science tattoo, because that's something he
Yes.
says in the original movie.
Oh my God, I loved that so much. I also loved that that shot was immediately following one where Darcy marries Howard
I
the
was not expecting that.
Duck.
Darcy is just always chaotic. She's just always in her own world, and I love seeing that because, when we're watching WandaVision, we see Darcy as, this adult who's been studying. She's got her PhD now, and she's like kind of a little bit more serious, but it's nice to see the fun, light-hearted Darcy who just wants to graduate.
Kat Dennings is always a win. I think she had the best line of the episode, which was, "I really don't think anyone would notice if you blow up one of the Dakotas."
Oh my goodness. Yes, that was she just has her one-liners. And that's something that you need in this episode because you have a lot of this like toxic masculine energy from Thor and his friends, and then you have this uptight Natalie Portman, Jane Foster, who just wants to like get things done, which I guess she's kind of the same character she always was. But then Kat Dennings is just like the perfect middle ground between the two.
Yeah, she's so chaotic. It's so much fun. Oh man, so many things. I also love that almost everyone in this was played by their original actors. I think this is the, in terms of like number of characters, this is the biggest percentage of returning actors we've had in one of these What If episodes.
Yes, you have Jeff Goldblum as the Grandmaster. We have Karen Gillan back as Nebula. You even see Colby Smulders as Maria Hill. Like, I was not expecting that because we haven't really heard much from her. I've been rewatching all of the Marvel movies recently with Zach, and
Oh
I
yeah, you
think,
told me about that. What are you guys up to?
oh, we finished it. We finished Endgame last
Oh, okay,
week.
cool.
But you don't hear a lot of Maria Hill after Winter Soldier. She kind of just like
Yeah.
disappears.
Yeah, she's in the post, I guess she's in the post credit of Infinity War, and then a fake version of her is in the Far From Home. But yeah, you're right.
She's also like in Endgame at the funeral, but like you
Oh
don't
yeah, she's at the
hear
funeral.
much. Yeah, you don't hear Colby Smulders' voice anymore. So it was really nice hearing her back because she's such a strong character. Maria Hill, I really hope that they bring her back for this next phase of Marvel because Maria Hill has so much potential of everything that's going to happen.
And she is like peak badass Hill in this, where she's not impressed with Captain Marvel.
That's
And
so
that was
weird.
great that she is dead flat, not at all impressed with her.
She just straight up, like, she is the actual female version of Nick Fury in this. She has no
Yes.
time for BS. She just wants to save her planet. And am I correct that Rumlow was there for a little bit? Like, he saw, like,
Yes.
oh, we never get to nuke anyone.
Yeah, that was really him. I've forgotten that actor's voice. I feel terrible, but that was really him. Clark Gregg was here as Coulson for a couple lines.
And then Samuel L. Jackson was there for two lines as Mysterio. It was so great.
And Taika Waititi was there as Korg for his two lines.
Oh my gosh. There were so many people. Like, you have the Asgardians of the Galaxy in there too. We found Drax. We have Rocket and like the reference to the rabbit in the sink. I was laughing so hard.
Oh my god.
No, I think this is probably the best What If episode I've seen, because all of the other ones, they didn't really entice me as much. They were very interesting and very well done. You know, again, Marvel never ceases to amaze me. But this was just so over the top, especially with that surprise ending.
Yeah, this was certainly the most fun. I'd have a really hard time ranking it and the Doctor Strange episode, which was my previous favorite. But these are like, I can't compare them well enough to rank them against each other, because no jokes in the Doctor Strange one. It's just solid 30 minutes of heartbreak.
It was just really dry for me. Obviously, it was heartbreaking, but I'm just like, I need... Because Doctor Strange himself, you know, he's a sarcastic guy. He has that nature to him, but it wasn't there, and I can't really like that episode. I do like it, but it's not going to be my favorite.
Yeah, they had the Armani joke, and otherwise that was pretty much the only humor in that whole episode.
Yeah, I needed his sass back, and that's what Thor was able to bring. He was able to bring the sass.
Thor, what I love is that Thor's not just bringing sass. He is bringing a college frat boy in the middle of a party sass. He's, we've got a word for people like you, a party pooper. That's right, oh my God. Said it.
Like, it reminds me of college, honestly.
Yes.
It reminds me, just like the general vibes he brings. He is, and that's kind of how he was in Thor before he got banished by Odin. He was this party guy that everyone loved, and you know, he knew how to have a good time, but he didn't have that responsibility with him. And I think that this episode also portrays that a little bit. Like, at the end of the episode, you see him and he kind of has a change of heart where, like, oh crap, my mother is going to actually hand my ass to me on a silver platter if I don't get my shit together.
Oh man. And that kind of felt very much like an 80s teen comedy of, oh shit, the mom's coming home, we gotta clean up this party as fast as we can.
Absolutely. Oh my gosh. I think just everything in this episode, all the minuscule details, this was full of just tiny little references here and there, and things that you wouldn't think that would be funny to watch, like him trying to fix the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Like,
oh,
you wouldn't think that that's something he would want to do.
I love that he just assumed that they broke that.
Yes, exactly. He doesn't even remember what he's done.
Something else that I noticed about this episode that I thought was kind of a fun parallel is that, in a much less noble way, this reminded me of the T'Challa as Star-Lord episode, in that when T'Challa becomes Star-Lord, just his being Star-Lord changes everything in the universe. Everyone is different. Everyone is changed just because he's there. And the same is kind of true here, that if Thor grows up an only child and becomes a party animal, that somehow Mantis doesn't wind up with Ego. Somehow Drax is like cheery and fun and hanging out at a party. Somehow Howard the Duck isn't captured by the Collector. The Grandmaster isn't still on Sakaar. He's hanging out and partying with Thor.
And Nebula, she referenced her father. Like, she's like,
yeah,
oh, I think my father's calling me. So she has a good, like, relationship with Thanos.
Like, are Thor's party vibes just so insanely badass that he's, like, made everyone lose their trauma?
So something that really threw me in for a loop was just the last 30 seconds watching Ultron robots and seeing this Vision variant just walk up with a bunch of Infinity Stones.
We're screwed. We're screwed.
Yes, that was exactly.
It's just like, we are screwed. I also love that the Watcher didn't see that guy. He goes, oh, wait, what?
And I think that's what made this episode extremely different, because in all the other
Yeah.
episodes, this narrator watcher knows everything. He's the one dictating what if. It's almost as if he, when he says the words, it happens. But
Yeah.
in this episode, he gets cut off short because he sees this and he just doesn't know what to do. And that's what threw me in for a loop, because now you're wondering, is this something that will be addressed in the future? Because it's very unlikely that Marvel would just leave something like that hanging.
So I'm betting, and this is just my little theory, that either I wonder if it'll be the last two episodes or just the final episode. The Watcher's gonna have to interfere because that's his whole thing in the comics, is he always vows he's not gonna interfere. I must not, I will not, I will only watch. And then something bad enough happens that he has to step in and do something. So I'm thinking that in typical Marvel fashion, all of these characters won't have been for naught, and the Watcher's gonna go get them and bring them together to fight this Infinity Ultron thing.
I can see that. I really can. Maybe the last episode, getting everyone together and saying, okay, y'all are the new Avengers. Go kick this robot ass.
Yeah, it's partly wishful thinking that I really want to see Captain Carter again because I love Captain Carter.
I was surprisingly happy with that episode.
And also because I know that Chadwick Boseman recorded four episodes and we've seen him in three. So some T'Challa is going to show up in these last two episodes, which I
I
can't
can
wait.
see it happening. I can see it happening. I'm super, super excited.
I
I
kind of
think
hope
that,
that's where we're going. I want to see Party Thor hang out with T'Challa, Star Lord, and
yes, that'd be
Captain Carter.
so great to see all of that. It's just because all of these other characters that you see are somewhat similar. Like you see Carol Danvers being the, badass thing that she is. And in all these other episodes, you have these like side characters that are basically the same, but it's these main characters that their stories are altered. And I think bringing them together is what will defeat this rogue vision.
Yeah, so what I'm curious, what do you think the odds are, just knowing Marvel in general, that something from What If shows up in live action in the next few years?
Oh, 100%, 100%. If there's anything I know about Marvel, it's that they've planned the next 10 years in their
Oh,
head, and they're
yeah.
already, like, you've seen their roster lineup. We have movies going until 2026 with solid dates in them. Like,
I
they
really
have
loved
everything planned.
I really loved that back when the Fox merger was like almost done but not quite done, someone asked Kevin Feige, so if it goes through, are we expecting the X-Men next year or the year after that? And I think his response was, we currently have 20 movies in development. He said this in like early 2019, because we currently have 20 movies in development. And once we get through those, then we'll start doing Fox stuff. And I'm like, man,
No, for sure.
this dude's unstoppable.
And I think they have to at this point, especially with their Fantastic Four movie coming out. I think Marvel doing Fantastic Four will really change the game, just like how they did with Spider-Man. We have the original movies, and then, Sony tried to do like a reboot of it, and it didn't really work out. But then Marvel took over and just completely changed the game. And I think that's what we're going to see in Fantastic Four, and then eventually
Yeah.
X-Men.
Is it the same director? I think it is.
Not sure. I am not into that. That's what I
I'm
have you
like,
for.
I am like 70% sure that they've signed the Spider-Man Homecoming and Far From Home director to the Fantastic Four movie, and that makes me very happy.
I'm very excited, and I can't wait to hear your thoughts about what's happening with Spider-Man Far From Home, because I have theories, I have thoughts. It is incredible.
Oh, the upcoming No Way Home. Let's
Oh,
do
sorry, yeah, No Way Home.
well, I'm gonna back up into the episode and then we're gonna do a discussion about that because I
Oh,
really want
yes.
to.
Little teaser.
So going back into the episode, one more thing that I thought was really funny was when Captain Marvel and Thor are fighting and they're like throwing each other across continents. and they had the like Looney Tunes names of the continents on the map.
It was so well done, and it goes back to kind of like the Watcher, because he's the one dictating everything, so it's kind of like the way you would see it in his head. He'd be like, oh yeah, he just threw him all the way to the Siberian continent, like, oh, now he's back destroying the deserts. And it's just like, it's so great, the cartoon aspect of this, because you don't see this much detail in live action sometimes. You can't cut that easily and just have everything look so fantasized. Like, that's the way it is with Thor in this sense. It's all like just mystical and magical, and it's a fantasy. So I really love the way that they animated it and was able to show it.
Yeah. I also really loved Captain Marvel absorbing the lightning. And also that she implied, I don't know if she was bullshitting or if she's overestimating or not, but she basically says, yeah, I could kill Thor if I wanted to, but it would take out like half the planet, so I'm not gonna.
I thought that was really funny. I genuinely believe her. She made Thanos scared shitless. I think she could take out Thor if she wanted to.
I thought that was great. She's like, I'd have to kill, you know, a lot of people and destroy part of the planet, but I could do it.
Like, you saw them fighting. It was as if they were just throwing punches with each other without the force of a literal Infinity Stone and a literal god behind these people.
What else? What else to say about this glorious episode? The rapid cleanup and the mom showing up, and Thor's got everyone pretending that they were just doing a little lesson. You gotta know, what do I always say, class? They go, learning is magic.
What got to me was the math on the board. Like, what is going on? Are you learning human math right now? Like, what are these derivatives that you're looking at? It's overall such a fantastic view of how this could have gone. And I think one big takeaway is that Thor, at the end of the day, was always going to learn his lesson. Like, whether he was an only child with no one to put him in his place, or whether he had Loki with this love-hate relationship, somehow he was going to have to grow up.
Yeah. This was such a cool episode. Nothing but good things to say about it. Cannot wait to see where we're going next. Based on the posters and stuff, we might be getting what if Gamora was in charge of Thanos' army.
I see that as the next one, because from what we see with Vision with the Infinity Stones, in this sort of what if timeline, in this these timelines, Thanos isn't going for the Infinity Stones. Vision or Ultron or whatever this thing is got it first. Maybe with this new episode with Gamora, because I think you're right, I think Gamora is the last quote-unquote last one before this epic battle. If she's in charge of everything, I don't think she would go for it. I think she would just want to go for peace at a different strategy. I want to see how you view this Gamora, because she doesn't have a good relationship with her father. So what would prompt her to lead his army?
I can't wait to find out. I'm so excited for the next episode. Do you have anything else on this Party Thor episode?
Just, it was nothing less than spectacular.
Yeah, I agree. All right, let's do a Spider-Man No Way Home bonus discussion, just because I feel like it. Oh God, there's so much. There's so much to say. Okay, so firstly, I gotta get your opinion on the theory going around that's not really Doctor Strange in the trailer.
So that was my theory. For some reason, I have this weird, weird feeling that that's not really Doctor Strange, because we get that he's arrogant and that, like, you know, he can do whatever he wants. But at the same time, he is a keeper of the Time Stone. Well, I guess there's no Time Stone anymore, but he's still, like, a protector of that realm. Why would he go out of his way to defy Wong and defy everything that the Sanctums, like, stand for to try the spell? I don't think that's what he would do. If he did do that, then I severely underestimated, like, his maturity, but
yeah. See, I'm on the other side of that coin. I'm thinking like, yeah, he seems about arrogant enough that if Wong told him not to do something, he'd do it just to prove that he can. And I believe that if Peter didn't have, you know, his panicky last, you know, moment changes, that Strange probably could have pulled this off correctly if Peter didn't interrupt him.
And that's another thing. I don't think it was Strange that messed up the spell. Like, he was a neurosurgeon. He could hear, like, a watch ticking, and, like, he would know what's going on. But I don't think it was him that changed the spell. I think it was Peter's affirmations and, like, Peter's words in that circle that changed the spell.
Oh, yeah, I bet it was Peter's words.
And at that point, Strange just couldn't contain it.
Yeah, and also, like you mentioned, the watch. He made the doctor cover the watch because he was worried it would distract him from what he was doing. And so, like, yeah, if Peter's just sitting there talking obnoxiously, I don't doubt that it could mess this up. But, man, if that's not Strange, I can't wait to see who it is or what their motivation is.
But at the same time, we know Marvel. We know that they like to alter trailers to make
that's also true.
Not what they seem. Because in Infinity War, in one of the trailers, we see Hulk hulking out. In the movie, we do not see Hulk hulking out.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't put it past Marvel to throw in those like curveballs with us. So that's another thing. Like, we don't know what's going to happen. Like,
yeah, I don't doubt it.
With the Green Goblin and the Lizard and the freaking Dr. Ock, like, we don't know what's actually going to happen. We get these snippets of nostalgia from when we were growing up because, like, what, the first Spider-Man movie came out in 2003. We were, like, 5 at the time. Like, we're having all of this nostalgia of growing up with these Spider-Man movies. Like, what kind of put Marvel on the radar of not just crappy live-action movies? And we are so excited for it, but is it really what we're going to end up seeing in the movie?
Yes, seeing Doc Ock again and seeing him de-aged to look about the way he did back then, it's like, that's eerie.
Alfred Molina is just a gem. Oh my gosh.
I can't wait. I can't wait to see how... I hope he's got a big role. I hope it's not like a 2-minute cameo or something.
I really hope not. I don't think they would do us dirty like that, but I also know that with Marvel, everything is not what it seems. So that's the point. I'm walking into this movie with no expectations.
Yeah. So do you think that we're on the subject of no expectations? Do you think that we're seeing Toby and Andrew show up in this movie? I think most people assume that we are.
I think most people assume that we are, just because if they don't, it would be extremely disappointing, not just from an expectation standpoint, but because these rumors have been floating around for years.
Yeah.
It's kind of like how it was with Endgame. Like, we all knew that everyone was coming back. We just didn't know how or when or, like, why. So you walk in with the movie, no expectations. I don't know how it's going to happen. I just know it's going to happen. That's how I'm walking into this movie. We're going to see Tobey Maguire. We're going to see Andrew Garfield. I wouldn't even put it past Marvel to reel in Kristen Dunst and Emma Stone into it, too.
Oh, that would be so cool.
I do not put it past them. I just don't know how they're going to do it because they never cease to amaze me.
I hope everyone's in it. I hope this is just like the most insanely ridiculous movie ever. I cannot wait. That one is December 17th. Can't wait.
Yeah, it has to. The way that they've done Loki, the way that they've done WandaVision, the teasing of all of these what ifs, and now potentially bringing this multiverse together, we know that this next phase of Marvel is going to move past the Infinity Saga and into the multiverse of the Marvel comics that Stan Lee created. I think that they have a lot to live up to, but they're going to do it so well.
I can't wait. I can't wait to see where this is going. I'm just like constantly excited all the time now. And it's great.
I know. Every time I see something, like, I have like all of the notifications on everything. I just like, please post something. Post something now.
Oh my God. It's all wonderful. All right. So as we close out, do you have any other, like, anything else you've been watching or listening you want to give a shout out to? A little recommendation.
Honestly, not really. I guess, I do have to say, very, very off topic, away from Marvel, Willie Garson did pass away the other day. He was in Sex and the City and he was in White Collar. So if you want,
Oh,
like,
wow.
yeah, so if you're into like a crime TV show, this white collar freak who just keeps on conning everyone, and then this FBI agent who tries to get him in control. It's a really, really good series. It's very funny. You have a brotherly, almost like father-son dynamic, and Willie Garson in there is just absolutely perfection. He is the chaos that keeps it all together. Highly recommend that, and he will be missed.
Oh, that's, I gotta go look that up. That sounds interesting.
White Collar, great out of great, like it's so great. It has Matt Bomer in it.
All right. I think my shout out is gonna be that I listened to Batman: The Audio Adventures, which is
Oh.
on, it's an HBO Max original. The whole series is there, but they're also putting them out 1 week at a time, one episode at a time on Spotify and on YouTube. And it's basically like picture a hyper modern version of an old 1930s radio show. And it's just, it's really cool. It's also surprisingly funny at times because basically the show makes you feel like you're listening to a radio station in Gotham. And so a lot of it is this narrative story about Batman, but then it'll occasionally cut to an ad break, but it's like Gotham ads and stuff gets interrupted by supervillains, or it'll be a PSA from the mayor
That kind of gives me WandaVision vibes.
Yeah, it's so interesting. High recommend, because I don't see anyone in my nerd fandoms talking about it, and it's so cool. I listened to the
Okay.
whole thing in this last week. It was great.
All right, send me the link. I'm going to take a look at that.
I will send you the link. Do you have any closing thoughts?
I've been following Marvel since Iron Man. It's been amazing seeing what they've been doing and what they are planning on doing. And I feel like everything is coming together in a really good way.
I love it. All right. So that'll do it for us in our discussion of What If. Once again, the show comes back every week to talk about every episode of this show. So be back next week. Until next time, never apologize for loving your fandom and try your best to stay optimistic. I'll see you guys next week.